spiritual practice. So I want to start though by just talking a little bit about spiritual practices in general. And I expect people to drift in as they come. So let me just throw this out to you guys. What is a spiritual practice to you? What is it when you hear that term spiritual practices, what does that mean to you? Any ideas?
Something we do regularly that helps us focus on our relationship with God.
Something that we do regularly that helps us focus on our relationship with God. Yeah, that's good. That sounds like a good definition to me. Any others?
Usually involves prayer.
Prayer? Is prayer a spiritual practice?
Yeah. I think so.
What are some of the spiritual practices you all have? Do you consider yourself as people who have spiritual practices?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Name, just throw some out.
Meditation.
Mm-hmm. What was that?
Just coming to church.
Coming to church.
Mm-hmm.
Is a spiritual practice just to show up?
It is. For me.
Yeah. Sometimes it's a spiritual practice to get out of bed. Right? It's a spiritual practice coming to the forums. For some. For some. Very, very few. But some.
Mm-hmm.
Bill, what are your spiritual practices beyond worship and prayer?
Well, obviously giving.
Giving. Obviously.
Yeah, obviously giving. Not only to the church, but to other organizations,
mm-hmm.
like the Humane Society and what have you.
Mm-hmm.
Also praying every day for those in my life who are sick or in need,
mm.
or who have passed.
Mm-hmm.
Prayer in the morning when I get up.
Routine. So
routines.
Something. Yeah, that's one of the common themes of spiritual practice. It's something that we build.
Because if I don't get it into a routine, I won't do it.
Yeah. Yeah. So part of spiritual practices is about developing routines that center us in God, as Alan suggested. And I think also to the opening prayer, I think can divert us to get us away from our busyness and our agenda and all the things that we get caught up in, to remind ourselves to center in God. And that's, of course, a big issue these days with the busy culture we live in. There was an interesting definition of spiritual practices that I appreciated very much, that we pretty much have captured here. But one of the additional statements which I liked was the idea that, in the end, spiritual practices are not our practices, but they are forms of participation in the practice of God. So that's an interesting way of looking at it. It's not little exercises that we do for ourselves, but it's our participation in the practice of God. So at the church I came from, my last parish, we had these as our spiritual practices. We offered this to the whole congregation as an invitation to adopt the following. Pray daily, worship weekly, learn constantly, serve joyfully, give generously, which is the topic of the day, and love wastefully. That was actually one I added.
Nice.
From the Bishop of Newark, the retired Bishop of Newark. I love that. So love wastefully, right? We've been talking about agape love last couple of weeks. A love that just goes out and doesn't care if it's ever reciprocated. A love that goes out and it's completely no strings attached. As much as you can give. It's just wasted out there. You know? That's awesome. So we'll do a forum on that sometime. But so let's talk about giving. So I always was stricken by that because I was like, wow, it puts giving right up there with prayer and with worship. You know, the big three, right, and serving. And I thought that was interesting because I had never seen that before. And as I got more involved in learning about giving and stewardship and scripture, I came to realize, well, it fits because after all, God, or Jesus, spoke quite a bit about money and about giving. And so it's important that would show up as a place for our spiritual practices to rest. So before we go into that, let's talk about why that's a difficult topic for people. Why is money and giving and all that stuff get people a little bit nervous? Why is that? You know, and what is it in our culture that would be particularly important for us as Christians in America, right? In the biggest consumer society that the world has ever imagined. Why would giving up our money be as important as ever? And so that's, you know, the old thing about money can't buy happiness. But, you know, maybe it can. Maybe that sign is right. So we'll talk about that. But we have an interesting relationship with money in our culture. I like this one as a follow-up. You're right, shopping won't fix the problem, but it'll put me in a better mood so I can deal with it. So what are some of our cultural attitudes about giving? When we give in our culture, what is it usually in response to? Or like, what is the sort of attitudes you see through fundraisers and through mailers that you get, or for appeals you see on TV, right? And what are some of the obstacles in our culture to giving, to separating ourselves from our money, right? So one of the ones I always think about is, you know, it starts with, it's mine, I earned it. So you need to convince me why I should separate from it, right? I worked hard to earn it, it's mine. So what is the reason I need to give this up? You better put together a really moving ad, you know, with dogs, with big wide eyes, behind bars, or whatever, and soft music, you know, to get me excited about separating myself from my money. So that's a huge issue. Do you ever see ego appeals when you in giving in our culture? Have you ever received a mailer that said, if you give a gift of over $500, you will get free tickets to the Gold Circle, you know, performance.
And your name will be somewhere.
Yes. If you give 1,000, we will put it on a plaque. If you give 2,500, it'll go on a gold plaque in bigger letters than everyone else. Right? We've seen that, have we not?
Sure.
Yeah. So what's the message there?
You can be important.
Can be important. And if I give, what am I going to get?
Recognition.
Get recognition. But it reinforces this idea of giving as a transaction, doesn't it? It's another consumer experience in a way. Right? If you give me this, I will give you this. I will give you a plaque. I will give you special tickets. I'll give you behind-the-scenes passes, an opportunity to meet the artist. Whatever. A tax deduction? Tax deduction. So, how about, and that gets to the consumer giving. How about, do they really need it? Can I trust them with my money? Does that ever factor into your decisions around giving? Remember all that stuff about I think it was the Red Cross at one point, got in trouble for how little of people's donations were actually going to the people in need? And so now we're kind of on guard about that, aren't we? Well, how much is this going to help the people you say? And that's, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. But it does, again, it reinforces this idea of, I don't know if I can trust. Part of giving, right, and this goes to the first point as well, when we give, when you really give, it's like loving wastefully. You just give. You give wastefully almost. You worry less about, I need to know where it's going, I want it to only go for this, I want to keep my control on it, I want to keep my strings attached, and I want to see a quarterly breakdown of exactly how my giving is being used, and I want to know who's on the board, and I want to have a vote on who is going to be in charge of that, whatever, right? In other words, we're extending our control, our desire for control into our gifts, right? So is that really a gift? It starts to get a little cloudy, doesn't it? Is it really a gift when we control what you do with it? do we give out of guilt or obligation ever? Have you ever heard that? Who's good at that?
The animal shelters, right? When they show those little beagles with the big eyes behind the bars.
How about the church? You know, we like to, you know, as Episcopalians, we read scripture in context, don't we? Right? We interpret scripture. We don't take it literally. We are very careful. We do a very careful exegesis. We want to know what was the different translations and what was the context on the ground, because it's not to be taken as a rule book, we say. Oh, but wait a minute. Then there's that thing about the tithe, 10%. We suddenly get a little literalistic there, don't we? what is everyone else doing? What's my fair share? Can I afford it? And that's really a big one, isn't it? At the end of the day, what keeps us from giving is often fears of this, right? Scarcity. So we often like to preach about the abundant life that Jesus calls us to. But in the reality, in the real world, most of us are living with some form of scarcity. You know, there's stats of something like 65 to 70% of Americans, which means Episcopalians too probably, are perhaps three paychecks away from having a concern about how they can make their rent or their mortgage payment. Maybe having to go into savings or something if they even have savings. When that's a reality for that many people in America, scarcity is a real deal. So do these giving attitudes find their way into the church? So here's a short little clip that I want to show. It's for fun. It's not meant to be any of you. But see if you can notice what are the attitudes around giving that you see coming out here.
And prepare for this morning's offering. Let each of us remember the scripture. As we have freely received, so should we freely give. Amen.
I suppose I ought to contribute something. After all, the church has to pay its bills too. Ed, these are comfortable seats, I must say. Comfortable seats, comfortable atmosphere. In fact, the whole place just says comfortable. And the congregation looks like they're doing quite well. This place must be rolling in the dough. What good is my measly couple of bucks going to do? Besides, how can I really know where my contribution's going? You can't be too careful these days. If I just keep my money, then I'll know exactly what it's being used for. I'm sure you'll understand, God, if I take a pass this morning.
Ah, yes, the offering. What a wonderful time in the service. There's something about being able to participate in what's going on here, to be part of funding this great work of God. A very, very large part. Sometimes I amaze myself, and I just know I could be such an example to others. Of course, how can I be an example if they don't know what I'm doing? I certainly wouldn't want to tell anyone what I give. That would be too obvious. Of course, if I don't fold my check, then the people next to me could see it. Maybe I could subtly prop it up against the rim. Then the whole row would be able to see it. Oh, but it might fall out. Hey, that would be perfect. Because then the people in the row in front would pick it up would see it too. And they'd have to pass it around to have it catch up to the plate. And then many more people would see it. And be inspired. And then, if they didn't get it to the plate in time, the person on the end would have to stand up and call out to the usher, "Oh, sir, sir, there's a very large check from a Mr. William Tyler, 7432 Whitfield Lane, that I am sure the church couldn't do without this week." And then the pastor would see what's going on and ask me to come up front. And then he'd probably make the honorary chairman of the board of directors right there. What a joy to be a humble tool in God's hands.
Oh no, the offering plate. I just hate this part of the service.
Feed me. Well, here it is. Chance to say thanks. You know, Lord, this has been a good week. I mean, every day I've had enough food, every night I've gone to bed in a warm house, and every morning I've had a hot shower. Well, except for Thursday when the kids got up early. But all in all, I've had a lot of good things come my way this week. And I'm glad that I have a chance to show you that while I know I matter to you, you matter to me too. To think 2 years ago, I would have been in the office on Sunday morning, slaving away, building my business, missing my family. But today I'm here. And now, in a tangible way, I get to show you, at least in part, how much I appreciate your presence in my life. This is for you, Lord.
I left my wallet in my car.
Sure you did.
Of course, that's none of us, right?
Well, and Chris, if you sit in the choir, you never have those problems.
You never have those problems.
Never have those problems. Because the plate doesn't come past.
Who would have thought that there's that much drama going out there in the pews with those plates going by? I remember that guy at the end, it kind of reminded me of a time where I was visiting a church in Minnesota, Lutheran church. And so the plate comes by, and we put $20 in, and there it goes. And at the end of the service, the usher comes back down with the plate, and he says, "By the way, did you need to make change?"
Really?
Oh, I guess the going rate is a little lower than $20. Anyway, I thought that was very sweet of them. They knew I was visiting and whatever, fumbled with my money and didn't want to pressure me into giving more than $20. So yeah, right? So you see some of those attitudes in a very caricaturized way on display. And I think, it's obviously way over the top in those examples, but if you look on the wall, that wall we've created, you'll see hints of some of that. I saw somebody said, "I give because the Bible says I have to." You know, that sounds like obligation, you know? I give because I need to in order to keep the church lights on or something to that effect. You know, okay. I mean, I'm not, again, there's no one reason. We're all on a different path as we go down our journey of generosity. But I just think that the cultural messages we have around giving, that it's our money, and you need to convince me about why I should separate from it, and all that stuff, I think it just seeps in. And there's never any better example than this email I got when I first started to work in the church development office as the stewardship director. I got an email that says, basically, "Chris, I want to let you know that I won't be able to make a pledge this year, at least not for the foreseeable future. Business has really slowed, and I need to watch things. Rest assured, I'll make a pledge as soon as things turn around." Smiley face. So far, so good. Oh, and he adds, "On a happier note, I won't be around the cathedral for the next several weeks as I'm leaving for a cruise to the Caribbean. See you when I return in October." Now, that is a legit real email, the identity covered, but it was funny, he or she sent that email to both me and the dean, so they were that brazen about it, so we both locked out and had a big laugh about it in the hallway, but it was just such an example of the disconnect, right, between our giving as an intentional act and our rest of our life.
He must have gone on a game show and won the trip.
Yes, maybe that was it. Maybe he had no choice, but he had to take it, right? Okay, maybe. But I've gotten other ones like that. I had one involving the new car as well. I remember, I'll never forget that one. This one's more fun, though, because it sounds more exotic. but yeah, it goes to the disconnect that we sometimes have. And it reminds me that we in the church still have a lot of work to do. And if you look at statistics, they show that Christians in general give about the same amount as every other American, as non-church-going Americans, about 2.5% of their income. So even though we have this gospel message, we have this idea of the tithe, we have this all these parables and stories from Jesus about why we should give, we're really doing no better and no more than anyone else. That's an interesting thing to keep in mind. So this question of why we give And how we can make it into a spiritual practice is before us. And it's before us this week as part of our pledge campaign. But it's really something that Jesus, I think, would have us have before us all the time. It is a continuing, it's part of our continuing conversion, if you will. One of the gospel stories I appreciate the most comes from Mark. And it is the story of the rich young man, and it's repeated in the other synoptic gospels as well. So I want to show you a clip of that. This is performed dramatically by Max MacLean, and it gives it a different flavor when the gospel is read dramatically.
As Jesus started on his way, a young man came and fell at his feet. "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus asked. "No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments: do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, do not defraud, honor your father and mother." "Teacher, all of these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack. Go. Sell everything you have and give to the poor. Then you will have treasures in heaven. Then come, follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked at his disciples and said, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed at his words. But he said again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, "Who then can be saved?" But Jesus looked at them and said, "With man this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God." Peter said to Jesus, "We have left everything to follow you." "I tell you the truth," answered Jesus. "No one who's left home or brother or sister or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields. And with them persecution. And in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first."
If you've never seen that before, I commend it to you. You can go on YouTube and just Google or just search the Gospel of Mark dramatic reading. And you could watch in one sitting the entire Gospel of Mark in about, I don't know, an hour and a half. It's really good, though.
Yeah.
He gives it such energy and vitality in a way that you just don't really hear, you know. You're not accustomed to hearing, anyway. So that was a big message, though, isn't it? But notice, as opposed to those earlier messages of why we give, Jesus' message is very different, isn't it? What did you hear Jesus saying to him?
Command. It's a command.
Direct command. Mm-hmm.
Necessary to following him.
Yeah. So, what I hear from that is those two combined to basically say, for Jesus, giving wasn't about ego, right? It wasn't about what you're going to get in return. It wasn't about getting your name on a plaque. It wasn't about obligation or guilt. He didn't frame it that way. It's framed in the way of you need to let go of one more thing that's holding you back from really following me. So it's your stuff, your money, as a barrier to following Jesus. Right? Because he says, I do everything. I've done everything right. I followed all 600 and some laws in the Torah. I've done all the commandments. What more do I need to do? Well, first of all, did he do any of those things? Was he following all the Ten Commandments, you think?
don't have a way to know, but probably not.
Included in that is loving your neighbor as yourself, by the way. I guarantee you he wasn't, okay? And I guarantee you, too, that Jesus knew that. So, he sort of loved him anyway. I appreciate you think you're... same as our gospel lesson today, basically. It's a similar message of the Pharisee, as you'll hear if you didn't hear it already. So Jesus is kind of like going, okay, this is the thing that's holding you back. It's your stuff. It's your stuff. Go get rid of it and see if you can follow me then. And that's how how Jesus typically talks about money. It's typically in the form of a barrier. So it's not about all the good it will do. It will do good. And it's not about obligation, although it is presented as something of a pretty direct request or command. It's really about freeing yourself to follow Jesus in the fullest way. Okay? So I invite you to imagine that as the beginning point for how giving starts to become a spiritual practice. It's no longer about the exterior. It's now about the interior. It's about relationship with God. How do I free myself and give up more of my life so that I will have new life in following Jesus in a totally radically different way, okay? That's the rich young man, rich young ruler. And by the way, are we the rich young man?
Yeah.
You think so? Rich young ruler? This is a good stat to always remember. If you have food in your fridge, clothes on your back, a roof over your head, and a place to sleep, we're doing better than 75% of the world. And if you add to that some money in the bank and some cash in your wallet, you're now doing better than 92% of the rest of the world. Last night, somebody was telling me, you know, Chris, I was thinking about this the other day. If I were to ever win the lottery, I am going to do so much good for homeless people. It was a beautiful vision. You know, he had this idea he was going to build this sort of shelter where there would be education and there would be job training and all this wonderful stuff. And I was like, wow, that sounds awesome. But it occurred to me that to 98% of the rest of the world, we already have won the lottery. Haven't we? And if you start to think of your life that way, that changes everything, doesn't it? We no longer have to wait for some event to happen, new riches to be discovered for us to begin to follow Jesus in a radical way. Here's another parable. This is from Luke 12, chapter 12. This is the story of the rich.
There was a time when Jesus was standing before a crowd, and a man said, "Teacher, tell my brother to share his inheritance with me." But Jesus said, "Who made me a judge over you?" And then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." And he told them this story. The farm of a rich man produced a good crop, and he thought to himself, "What shall I do? My barns are too small. I have no place to store my crops." And it was such a good take that he couldn't fit all the food into his barns. It was bursting at the seams. "This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns, and then I'll build bigger ones, and there I'll store all my grain and my goods." "And I'll say to myself, you've plenty of good things laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry. But God said, you fool, this very night your life will be taken from you. And then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with anyone who stores up things for himself, but is not rich toward God."
We don't have barns in our culture, do we?
What is that website?
Four car garage is probably because of storage. You never have enough storage, and so you never have enough garages. Never enough. So much stuff. So little space. Even though the average new house has grown larger every decade, now many new homes have three car garages. Nearly 900 square feet of garage space alone. Is almost the size of an entire home in the 50s.
And then it's going to be just perfect.
So yeah, so I'll give you that website after. But yeah, so barns, bigger barns. During the recession, a lot of people don't realize this. As bad as the economy got during that Great Recession, what was the growth industry? Any guess? Storage units.
Uh-oh.
Storage units. Storing stuff that you can hold in your house. I used to represent clients that owed back taxes to the IRS, and we had to always try to cut a deal. My job was to cut a deal with the IRS, convince them they can't get paid. My client can't pay you back. He doesn't have all the money. So we're going to cut a deal and pay you what he can. And over again, those clients were driving nice cars, living in bigger houses than both myself or the IRS agent. And 9 times out of 10, they were paying rental on storage units, the sort of stuff that they didn't need or couldn't use or wanted to keep for whatever reason. And I'm, by the way, a serial violator myself. This was our home office, so that's correct. Up until recently, when that was turned into a nursery, our home office, my computer had its own bedroom. My computer had its own bedroom. So in that last couple slides ago, right, that 75% or 98% of the rest of the world, or 92% of the rest of the world, a good chunk of that rest of the world, there's an entire family shares a room that big. And here in our big barns, I had a computer that had his own bedroom. So there's a book out a few years ago called Your Money or Your Life, and it offers an understanding of that earlier slide and this sort of tension we have in our culture around does money buy happiness or not? And it's something called the fulfillment curve, and it basically tries to suggest that as you spend more money, okay, as the more money you spend, the more happiness you get. So their argument is that that's very true. Okay? That's very true. The more money we spend is actually very true when it's the first stuff, right? So the house, the roof over our head, some food on the table, some clothes in the closet, right? We're going to get a lot of satisfaction when we spend on necessities. Because you got to have it. So we do get a lot of happiness for that. Survival goods, okay? A little bit of money, a lot of happiness because we're surviving. You go further out, though, once you start getting beyond survival goods, now you're in the comfort goods. Whatever those are happen to be for you, right? They're different for everybody. For me, it's a big screen TV, maybe, right? Or maybe that's a luxury good, I don't know. But the point is, as you spend more money, you're spending the same amount of money, but your happiness is leveling off, right? Mm-hmm. The first pair of shoes isn't as precious to you as the 100th pair, right? That make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, it continues on out to luxury goods. And then, you know, does the gold-plated belt buckle really give you that much more happiness? And then the point is, at some point, your stuff can actually become and cause you to lose happiness. So for my tax clients, they were in that situation. Their stuff was causing them legal problems. Or maybe you're having to hire, purchase security alarms and so forth to protect your stuff. Or maybe you're having to hire accountants now to keep track of all your stuff because it's too expensive and you got to depreciate things and it's getting very complicated. And that's when we start getting into clutter. So their argument is, as part of a spiritual practice around giving, it begins with you deciding in your life, wherever that happens to be, when do you have enough? So our culture is very good. All of our consumer culture wants to just push you further out on this, always, right? Always, always. More is better. Our goal as Christians, really, is to have our rich young man moment and say, okay, I've got what I need. I'm going to stop accumulating, and I'm going to begin following Jesus. And by doing so, achieve levels of happiness far more than you could ever get from more stuff. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So that's kind of like a graphical thing, an attempt to graph the rich young man parable in a sense. So giving can become a spiritual practice when it helps to keep God a priority in our life. So what are some basic practices around that? Is always begin with prayer and gratitude. Does anybody here have a spiritual practice, speaking of that, of just giving thanks every day?
Yes.
Yeah. That's a good place to start if you don't have that. Another one, stretch yourself. When you give something that you're going to miss. If you give comfortably, you're probably, I would invite you to give till it's uncomfortable. Give from your first fruits, meaning don't give what's left over. Give from off the top. That's why people talk about the tithe. So 10%, whether it's 10%, 5%, whatever percent, pick a percent and just commit that I'm going to give that. I'm going to make God a priority. That's what that does. It honors God as a priority in your life. To say, I'm going to give from my income, not from what's left over after I buy all the stuff that I want. Right? Budget around giving. Be intentional. Okay? Some of the things. Consider giving anonymously. Would we give the same if we gave anonymously? There's a good another spiritual practice around giving, around money in general, is to track what you spend. Does anybody do that?
Oh.
Some people not. Track what you spend. How many people have ever done a nutrition exercise where you had a nutritionist say, I want you to track everything you eat? Mm-hmm. Have you done that? What does that cause you to do?
Be
cheat.
Cheat?
Lie.
It does.
Not really.
It serves as an interrupt, though, doesn't it? You have to log everything
you're
doing.
Honestly, yeah.
It causes you to kind of go, okay, maybe I'll skip that. I don't want to have to show it to them. I don't even have to write it down. So track what you're spending. Try doing that with spending. Try that as a spiritual practice for 30 days. Write down everything you spend and see if that doesn't cause you to be more thoughtful and intentional about what you spend your money on, such that you might have more to give. And then the other issue is budgeting. That's another part of it. There's a great easy program called Mint.com. It's free. You can get it on any device these days, and it's a way of to doing all of that very easily. And then the last couple of slides I'll show you is if you start to budget, okay? Budget can help turn your giving and all your whole money life into a spiritual practice when you start with giving. So as you build a budget, for example, rather than give, you start with giving, you start with saving. Start there. Make a decision. Make a goal. I'm going to give this much, 5% of my income, whatever. Start there. And then I'm going to save 10%, let's say, whatever. And then I'm going to pay down any debt I have. Okay? Pay down debt. And then I'm going to learn to live on everything else. That's the way to build a budget. Unfortunately, our culture will instead of giving and saving as a priority, and then living on what's left over, I call that people would call that the 10-10-80 rule. Give 10%, save 10%, live on the 80%, assuming you've paid off your debt. The culture, on the other hand, is going to tell us money buys happiness. Enough is never enough. More is always better. And by the way, once you run out of money, incur debt to buy more, right? And then save. The savings rate in this country was almost 0% a few years ago. Savings is kind of like not an issue. That's what credit cards are for. And giving is an afterthought. It's what's left over if you could use a tax deduction. I mean, that's like the extreme version. But that's the culture what would have us do if we left to our own devices. The thing about setting priorities around how you live and how you give and how you save, it changes the way you organize your life. And that's really what a budget does. And that's an important vehicle towards developing your intentionality around money and turning giving into a spiritual practice. Budgets help us to set goals, stay within a safe zone. If you live within a budget, you know you're okay. You're not going to have anxiety about money. And most importantly, it frees us up to do the thing that God is really calling us to do. That's the intentionality around money, around budgeting. If we can live within our means, and that means often downsizing, really. That really often means downsizing, because the typical Americans have very little savings and very little extra in case something ever goes wrong. And so savings and giving is a last resort. It doesn't really happen very well. So what's the answer there? The answer there is to start living within our means. It's to have a rich young man moment. Live more simply so that you can live more fully. That's the message of the rich young man. And that is how we moved from a world of scarcity to this abundant life that Jesus describes. The abundant life will never be in more stuff, and certainly not can be found when we're anxious about enough. It'll be found when we scale ourselves down and live within our means so that we can start following Jesus in the way that we're called to do. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. So that's it. We have a few minutes. Is there any questions? That's the.
I don't have a question.
That's the breakdown of the.
Just a comment.
Yeah. Yeah.
I understand budgets and I understand giving financially. However, I would like to suggest that if we give of ourselves in any capacity, whether it be in church, in our neighborhoods, somebody at the grocery store, it doesn't always have to be monetary.
No,
and,
that's right.
And truly,
yeah.
Since we're approaching the season, I would like to see that incorporated as well. I mean, that doesn't negate not budgeting, you know, church and your pledge and so forth.
Yeah.
But
that is absolutely right. Jesus would have us give our whole self.
Yeah. And that's what I'm saying. You said it.
Yeah.
Encapsulated in whole self.
Exactly. The point of this is most Americans are really good at giving their whole self, except.
Is that right?
I
don't really know.
Well, the average Christian gives no better, no more than the average American. The average atheist gives the same amount of money as the average Christian.
Hmm.
Okay? So we are, by that measure, we are no better at giving our full self. We draw the line at our checkbook just as strongly, just as quickly as those who don't follow Jesus. So I hear you. You're quite right. We're all in. But I'm just inviting us to reflect on whether or not we want to have God in all the areas of our life that are comfortable and are easier, and we want to draw the line at our money. That's the area that I would invite some reflection during these next few weeks. And we'll spend lots of time on how you can give your time and talent.
Do you see a significant variance in age groups giving? Say, somebody from my generation.
I haven't seen that.
Oh, okay.
I would be interested in seeing.
Yeah.
I would assume demographically, as you get older, you're able to give more as you get older. Because you've paid off things.
Yeah, yeah.
You're no longer saving for somebody's college and that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Right. And you don't habitually go into Starbucks and drop $5 for a cup of coffee. I mean, it goes against my grain. I mean, I love coffee, but to pay that kind of money for a cup of coffee?
And there's
I don't think so.
Yeah. And there's also wild generational fluctuations, too, between those who went through the Great Depression, for example. This kind of thing, to my grandparents, they'd be like, why would anybody need to learn that? Everybody knows that. Don't they?
No,
they don't. But their generation learned it.
Absolutely.